All right. I guess we're going live, Jung.
Are we?
Are we?
It is summer, summertime. Well, it's the summertime here in Europe.
We are live. Yeah, it's summertime. So our clock went an hour forward. That one now. Good morning. I hope all people are in time because the clock, the time changed this night.
Yeah, so we had 1 hour less.
Less sleep. Yeah.
Yeah.
You can see that.
So yeah. Yes.
Are you okay?
Sorry about it. Well, okay is an overstatement, but I'm here.
I still have a young son, so I don't care about
it. We are on time.
You don't have any young children, so
no.
It's probably pretty hard for you. We have a very interesting test today. We have three loudspeakers, and we're going to test them on three amplifiers. So that's, I think what we're trying to search is the right combination per loudspeaker.
Yeah, and the interesting thing is that they are about 1,000 euros.
Yeah.
A pair.
A pair, yeah.
So what we see is that when we write reviews, of course we write reviews on amps that cost, that will set you back about 16,000 euros. That's for the happy few, of course, but the reactions or the most views we get from this price range.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
yeah,
below or on 1,000 for an amplifier, for a pair of speakers, for a streamer deck or so.
It's very popular. I think the quality starts there.
Yeah, well, actually the quality, what we found out is that the quality has improved over the years.
Oh yeah, definitely.
In this category.
Yeah.
It's amazing what the performance ratio of this stuff is right now.
It's ridiculous. We tested 1,000 euro amplifiers lately, a couple of weeks back. It's a very well received article, so thank you all for that. And by the way, thank you for all the Patreon supporters for Alpha Audio. I see one in the chat, so thanks. Also, because of you, we can do this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Because of our Patreon supporters. And we are working on something on the website specifically for Patreon supporters.
Yeah, we have some suggestions we got from you guys, so
yeah.
We welcome that.
Yes, definitely.
And it takes some time to think about it on what to do.
Yeah, well, I sent them a message yesterday.
Yes,
about
privately, but not, you know, publicly.
No, not on YouTube.
So if you have any ideas on
let us know.
On preferred supplier or preferred Patreon treatment.
Yes.
By us.
No massage.
Let us know in the comments on the right or below.
We have some viewers from Australia, The Hague, The Hague. But we were talking about quality.
Yeah,
I think the amplifier test proved that you can buy a very good amplifier for 1,000 euros. And we have one still in the system, the Nuprime IDA8. And it's one of the amplifiers I preferred from that test, but that's my taste. But I think it's a very good amplifier, modern. It looks great, digital inputs, analog input. Maybe two inputs would be more flexible, but it's a very good amplifier. And that's why you took it in this test. And we have, of course, our Yamaha A-S2200. That's not a 1,000 euro amp.
No.
It's a 3,500 euro amp. But we are going to check out whether the speaker grows with the amplifier.
Yeah.
And how it matches in that case.
And that is because we also get fewer questions that says, well, I'm thinking about buying a new speaker and I have this and that amp. And what do you suggest? And then we often say, well, why don't you try, when you're satisfied with your speakers,
yeah,
you might as well try a new amp, because what we are testing right now is maybe the difference is in the amp. So in the apparatus that controls the speakers. And we often found out, also in my home system, that it really makes it really matters on what amp you attach to your speaker, even more so than a speaker, because the speaker has its characteristics, but the control, you know, the grip
on the speaker is very important. Yes, definitely. I totally agree with that. It's all about grip and control, and that's why our last combination is completely bollocks and nuts. But we're gonna put our own Pass Labs pre and power amp on it. We recently bought the X150.8 from Pass Labs. It was a dream amplifier, Jung. I realized one of my dreams.
Well, I'm glad for you.
Yeah, I'm really happy with it.
You're now totally pass.
I'm totally passed.
You passed away. No, you didn't pass away.
No.
When your dream come true, you pass away.
Yes.
Oh, that's not a nice tagline.
I must admit, it was kind of a roller coaster because you have these expectations about everything being better after buying such an amp. But that is absolutely not true. I changed more than only the amplifier after that. Yeah, I did. I bought the Grimm UC1. Another DA converter, because the Sonat Pasitea is a beautiful converter, but it doesn't always match with the Pass Labs power amp. It's too much up front. It gets kind of aggressive sometimes, and that's about the balance in the system. I wrote a...
But you would say that the preamp...
Does more.
Does something... With the deck and the...
I thought so too. Nope. The power amp had a huge impact in the balance of the system.
And did you attach the Pasitea directly into the power amp as well?
Yeah, and that's insane. It's so good. It's ridiculous what it does. The Pasitea directly into the Pass Labs is like... It's like cocaine.
So almost. The XP12 is for sale now.
No, I'm not going to get rid of it because it does something that the Pasitea doesn't. And I'm still figuring out what the balance in the system will be like in a couple of weeks. And maybe the Focal will be gone.
Sopra.
Yeah. Because it is a beautiful speaker, but yeah, it's like matching, you know. It's like a marriage. You like some stuff, you don't like some stuff.
You win some, you lose some.
Yes, you do.
Yeah. Well, that's it's true. It's about match. Especially in the league you're talking about right now.
Yeah, it's all about match.
It's high end. It's very sensitive stuff.
Yeah, very.
Every point in the chain,
every link
in the chain matters.
Yeah, it all does. So, people...
Don't try this at home.
No, and that's why I absolutely love that 1,000 euro range. Because it offers you insane quality. It offers you good resolution. It offers you good quality reproduction of the music. But it's not as critical as the stuff we are playing with on a daily basis here at Alpha. Like the Pass Labs and the Grimm and the Sonnet. Because they are so revealing... that you hear every mistake,
yeah.
Everything. And it's kind of a pain in the ass sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah. That's why back in the day, I decided not to buy a name CD player, but a Rega.
Yeah.
Because that one sounded much more warmer and more musical.
Yeah.
And with name, you could hear every, well.
Every mistake.
It was too analytical. It was, you started to listen to the faults.
Yeah.
And here, of course, we use it more for work purposes, actually.
Yes.
It's measuring instruments. We are trying to discern the differences.
Yeah.
So we need stuff that is as transparent and revealing as possible.
Yes, and that's why we bought the Pasitea, which is a great DA converter. That's why we play with Pass Labs for a long time now. It's great stuff. It lets you hear everything. I thought the X150.8 would be warmer sounding, but it isn't. It's very, very neutral. and people that say that's a warm sounding amp, no, it isn't. It just isn't. The Bryston is much
neither
warmer.
On the Sopras, it's not warm.
Nope. Okay. Absolutely not. The Bryston is right. Much warmer and much more
colored.
Forgiving. Yeah, that's the word. The Bryston is more forgiving, and that's why it went so well with the rest of the system.
Bryston is merciless.
It's merciless. Yes, in a way it is. There must be more merciless power out
that,
there.
I read some of Nelson Pass's blogs.
Yeah. Blogs. Yeah, he blogs. Yeah.
And he doesn't say that he makes merciless power amps. Don't you, Nelson?
Well, you do. You do. Let's get to... I measured all the loudspeakers. I didn't look at the measurements, honestly, because otherwise you will be biased.
So it's a blind test.
It's kind of a blind test in a way that I didn't look at the results of the measurements in depth because I just checked if they were reasonable. We measure with a system made by Illasonic. It's a Swiss guy. And we use a DPA measurement microphone. And we measure in this room, in the dead part of the room. There's a cinema at the back. And it's very damped, but you don't look at the low frequencies, please. Just look at 200 hertz and up, and then you get a good idea of what the speaker measures like. So everything below 200 hertz is more of an indication. It's not very accurate because we measure in room, and you need a anechoic room to measure up to 20 hertz. We will show the measurements in this test as well. And we're going to start with Focal. First, a little bit of history. I looked it up. I don't know everything.
Start out as JM Labs.
Yes, I did know that.
No.
And it's not on their website. That's pretty weird.
It is.
It is? Oh, I didn't see it.
It's because they speak French.
Ah. It was founded in 1979 by Jacques Mahul, JM Lab. And the office was in Saint-Étienne, just like it is now.
Still is, yeah.
It's pretty big. I went there a couple of years back. Yeah, it was quite cool, actually. It's a big factory, and they do their R&D and the production in France. Most of the speakers, not all of the speakers. Some are built in China, but they still ship their stuff there, produce it there. And then it gets shipped back. I think it's ridiculous that they do it like that.
Yeah.
Companies should
stop. They are thinking about relocating, but that will take time because of the war, because of the pandemic.
Yeah, but you know, these days, shipping it to the other side of the planet and shipping it back is just...
That's what I'm saying. I think it would be good if the globalization at that point would be more...
Yeah, focused.
Focal.
I mean, focal. It's good to cooperate, of course. You can share knowledge, and you can share R&D, and you can share maybe some electronic stuff that you need, but shipping the components there, producing it there, and shipping it back is too heavy on the environment.
Well, already in 1982, Focal introduced the DB13, which was the bookshelf loudspeaker with Kevlar in it.
Initially, it was built for France only, but it was such a success that he built it on the larger scale.
Yeah.
And it was the first speaker. And it had the inverted dome, I think, the DB13 already, or doesn't. Was the model after that?
The poly-Kevlar speaker driver. No, not inverted dome.
Oh, no, not yet. That was done. The successor of the DB13 had the inverted dome.
But like this.
And you can see it on the... Aria 906 as well. The dome is the other way around. So maybe if Eric can show the loudspeaker, you can see that the dome is inverted. And they used that principle for a long time. And I don't think other companies can use it anymore.
I don't know. Well, I don't know if they make OEM. But
No, I'm not sure anymore.
In 1995 they introduced the Grand Utopia,
yeah.
which is 220, it's like...
It's huge!
Like this sofa and then upright.
Yeah, it's huge.
You heard it once.
Yeah, I did. The latest version.
How was it?
Yeah, it was completely... It's really an experience because they played it on my favorite amplifier of all time, and that's the name statement, with the 500 series streamer on it. And it was just, we have one torture track since the early days of Alpha, that's Angel by Massive Attack, and he laughed because he knew how hard that track is. It's such a heavy load in the bass, and if you have a full range loudspeaker, you hear it very soon, that bass, because it starts very deep and then it builds up. It was just flawless. It was insane. I could hear everything. It was not stressful. It was not harsh. It was just high end and really well balanced. But that's because they merged with Name in 2011, I think. They merged. And well, if you cooperate, you can tune your stuff very well. The new Grand Utopia must be tuned on the statement. It was such a happy marriage. It was really good.
A match.
It was a match, yes. I thought it would be more airy and fresh and harsh.
Yeah, Folk was also active in automotive and in the studio. They have a studio range of loudspeakers, so they're really on a wide range of products. And headphones, of course. And headphones, the L-ear.
They do. Yeah, we have the L-ear. It's an older one. I still like it. I hope the build quality is a little bit better now. Because, for a €1,000 headphone, it's not really well built. The cords, they break.
Oh.
Yeah, they do. But you can change it out. But it's, I don't know, €100 plus to buy a new headphone cord. And the frame, it's metal, but it bends after a while. So you have to be careful with it. And we use it as gear around the office, of course. And it falls sometimes because we use it for our streaming setup and sampling setup. And it gets heavily used. But still, I think they could make better quality headphones.
I think the nice thing about Focal is that it, you know, they have the Utopia, which will set you back about €250,000.
A pair.
But they also have speakers that will start like these at about €500-600 a piece, or even less.
Yeah.
So that's the nice thing, I think, about this brand. So they have very, very high-end stuff, and they have very affordable, and everything in between.
Yeah,
and I think they're in the room.
It's a good strategy, because if you invest in, you know, speakers like the Grand Utopia, you do all the R&D for that loudspeaker.
Yeah,
you can sell it for a lot of money, and you can use that technology and trickle down in more affordable models. And I think that's why the Sopra series is so extremely successful, because it's not an Utopia, but it's getting very close already. Utopia has some very cool technology, but that's a whole other league. And we're not talking about the Utopia, so thank you. We're talking about the Aria.
Yes, we could talk length on these.
Oh yeah.
You know, that's something about, you know, almost all audio brands have a story. And
they do.
We think it's important to know and share the story, because it says so much about the brand.
Yeah.
As long as it's still in the original hands, we would say.
It got sold.
It got sold?
Yeah, well, they merged with Name in 2011, and they created a new holding group called Vervent Audio.
Yes, you're right.
And in 2014, Nexacap bought the Focal Name Group. Now, there's always a story behind that. It doesn't have to mean that the new shareholders demand
only shareholders' value or money.
I hope that it will be a more fluid story than with other brands that we know that are being bought and sold and bought and sold and bought and sold, because I think eventually they'll lose their signature and soul.
Yeah.
And that's a pity, because we lost a lot of good brands that way. So please, please keep these two beautiful brands alive, and don't only demand winst.
Profit.
Yeah.
Don't look at the figures.
Don't
always. But I think also the clients who buy Utopias.
Yeah.
They don't mind money either.
No.
So if these brands are interchangeable between any other brand, you know, they lose their, well, their specialty and their uniqueness in a way.
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Hey, Marvin, friend of mine is watching.
Let's listen to the focal.
Yeah, first a track. And then I'll talk about the measurements and the specifications, okay?
So what we do, because we have, as you are used of our reviews, we have three tracks.
Yeah.
And now we have one track per amplifier.
Yeah, true.
So the first track, which is our well-known French, because we keep it French, it's Jacques Lussier.
Yep.
We will play it via the Pass Labs.
Yeah, so this is the absolute Jab's bonkers
new,
combination.
Jab's new love baby. So we'll do Jacques on the Pass Labs. We'll play the second track. We'll play on the Yamaha.
Yamaha, yeah.
And we'll reveal the second track later on. And the third track we'll play on the Nuprime. So after each track, we will have a short intermission. Well, Jaap will change the cables and stuff.
Yeah, and then I need to align the new loudspeakers to the microphone, so that will be.
But the loudspeaker is later, so we do first the focal with the three amps, right?
Yeah, and then we change the loudspeaker.
So we have a lot of changing.
Yeah, it's an intensive test, so please
and,
stay with us.
In the meantime, I can answer your questions or so. So
yeah, sure.
We'll see how far we can go.
Yeah.
But because we cannot play all three tracks or three amps, and then, so you have nine tracks per speaker.
No.
It would be too much. It would be too much for you and for us.
Yeah. It's too
so
intense.
Bear with us.
Jacques
And now Jacques on the pass.
Yeah.
And the focal. Yep, help me.
Aria 906.
Aria. Is that the cheapest one in the line?
Yeah.
You can get from bookshelves?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because the Oberon is.
Oh, that's Dali, my friend.
Sorry.
No, you have Aria, you have Coral, that's beneath the Aria.
Yeah.
So the Aria is the second line. And then you get Canta, and then you get
Canta.
Sopra, and then you get Utopia.
Thank you.
Yes.
Jacques. Thank you. Well, this is like a Formula One engine driving a deux chevaux. Okay.
Come on. You hear that it's overkill. It's kind of a break on the amplifier. It wants to do more, and you hear that it can do more.
Yes.
But it's not surprising. I mean, come on, it's a 16,000, no more. Holy shit.
24?
No, it's 16,500 euro amplifiers on 1,000 euro speakers. It's 7 and 8 and a bit.
Ish.
8-ish. 87 and 72. So it's ridiculous. No one does this.
But you also heard this on the Yamaha and on the Nuprime.
Not yet, no.
Not yet.
No, I'm all ears.
Blind.
I'm completely blind in that way. Yeah. So I'm gonna change to the Yamaha. Maybe you can tell something about the specs of the 906.
Yes. Wait a minute. I also have to answer some questions, of course.
Yeah.
Okay, the specs of the 906, and we did the measurements ourselves, but we'll get back to you later because these measurements are from the factory. So, the range, it starts at 55 hertz, and actually you could hear that it starts at 55 hertz until 23 kilohertz at minus three dBs. The units, there are two. It's two-way speakers, so you have this nice inverted tweeter. We also see at the professional line. It has 16.5 centimeters driver, bass driver, MDF housing, and crossover is at 2,800 hertz. And
yeah, it's pretty high.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and what is the rendement?
They're
pretty high. They're 89.5 dB sensitivity.
Sensitivity, thank you.
They're so sensitive, and they are 8.5 kilograms, and they will set you back 1,200 euros.
Yeah, recommended resale price. So if Eric can put in my laptop now, I can show you the measurements.
Already, yes, before, okay.
Yeah, we can do that. As you can see here, it's the frequency response, but it's without any time window, so it's a full range frequency response, this. If you look from 200 hertz, you can see it's pretty straight with a small bumpy in the end. I think that's the focal signature because my Sopra does the same in a way, but a little bit less. This is with a time window, so it's smoothed out a little bit. So we only measure the first 3 milliseconds. So you measure the loudspeaker purely, not the room. But you can't look beneath 200 hertz. So it's pretty smooth, it's pretty straight. This is an interesting one. This is the perceptual simultaneous distortion. So it's how we hear the distortion from the loudspeaker. Mm. And you can see is a small bump around 1500 hertz, and that's where the third harmonic is also very dominant, and it can be, well, a little bit harsh. The Sopra has quite the same signature, but it's a lot lower, so you don't hear it as much. This is impulse. It's not really interesting for you guys right now. We'll put it in the review, but whatever. And this is the simultaneous distortion. You see the bump around 1500 hertz again. And you can, for your information, this is measured in decibels. The left axis and the horizontal axis is the frequency. Around minus 45 is 1%. And for me, that's kind of a benchmark. It needs to be beneath 1%, I think. Well, the bass isn't really, and there's a bump around 1500 that goes above 1%. See?
Yes.
Around here? I think it's a little bit too high for my taste. It should be around minus 50.
Yes, you could hear the mids are quite slightly stressed.
So you need an amplifier with kind of a smooth character to get rid of that. Okay, Eric, I'm finished with the laptop.
A forgiving one.
Yeah.
So now we will, wrench the Yamaha.
Yeah, I need my remote. It's over there.
And, where's the remote? Is it already? And we have a very nice tune for that. And because we start with the American singer Suzanne Vega. And of course you will know this song. We'll play it.
There it is.
Is it on?
Morning at the
diner. Oh, that's really loud.
I am waiting at the counter for the man to pour the coffee. And he fills
I'll do the little later.
I even argue he is looking
that's
out
okay.
the window at somebody
five seconds.
It is always nice to see.
Yeah.
Oh, so this song, Tom's Diner, Suzanne Vega, was used, for?
Yeah, it's kind of the father for the MP3, of the mother of the MP3. Sony, Suzanne Vega, Tom's Diner was used to tune the first versions of the MP3. Because Fraunhofer was working on it, if I remember correctly.
The German Audio Institute Fraunhofer.
Yeah, exactly. And they said, we're finished. And then they did a demo in front of some people. And one said, can you use Suzanne Vega Tom's Diner? And I said, sure, we can do that. And they used it. And it sounded absolutely crap. So they had to go back to, the coding table to fix it. And they used this track to tune the codec because the vocals were so harsh in the first version of the MP3.
It didn't use any effects, almost.
Nothing.
No compression.
And that's why it's such a good track to tune a codec. It has to sound natural. And you can hear instantly that it's quite harsh, actually, the track. It's really in your face. It's really close mic.
It's like live. It's like...
Yeah, maybe. Yeah,
have,
in a way.
Have
SM58.
Like this,
in your throat.
It's like this.
Okay.
I'll play the from the same artist.
Yeah, another track.
Shall we play some music?
Yeah, let's go.
Otherwise, it's more talk radio than music.
Talk radio, yeah. Okay, Eric, there we go.
We'll play from the same album, the second track, Suzanne Vega, Luca.
Try not to talk too loud. Maybe Yes, I think you've seen me before. If you hear something late at night, some kind of troublesome kind of fight, just don't ask me what it was. Just don't ask me what it was. Just don't ask me what it was. And they only hit until you cry. After that, you don't.
I hope you like the music.
Yeah, it's a nice track. What do you think?
Well, there is a little sharpness.
Yeah.
It's harshness
kind of,
or something.
Kind of upfront.
Yeah.
I think, because that's really what struck me as well, I think the match with the Yamaha is not ideal. So I'm really curious about the Nuprime.
Well, the Yamaha is a what's the price? 3,000.
Yeah, but it's a kind of a lightweight amplifier.
Is it? I thought it was quite.
No. It has a lot of control, but it's tuned extremely neutral.
Okay.
Just like the pass laps.
Well, then you wouldn't expect because it was quite sharp. I don't know if you heard it at home, but it was quite.
Yeah, they did.
The highs were quite sharp.
Yeah.
And okay. I hope, Martin Zelstra, you will get your system right, because...
We're broadcasting 1080p and we have redundant internet lines, so it should be working. Refresh your browser probably helps.
Yeah. Command R. But if you...
yeah, exactly.
It was very... I think for mixing purposes, it would be nice, because you hear so much mid frequencies. Too much highs to my taste, but the mids are, I think if you would a little bit, I would EQ the highs a little bit.
Yeah,
less.
You would. But that's funny, because I had a discussion with Guido Tent about distortion, because of the tuning of the system. And he said, if your distortion in a certain range is high,
mm-hmm.
you tend to EQ it down.
Yes.
But you won't get rid of the distortion.
No, of course not. No.
So that's funny.
You make it less
apparent.
Unpleasant, or you make it disappear a little bit.
Yeah, but you keep EQing,
sure.
Because it's always, you're fixing something not with the right tool. You need to get rid of the distortion. The 1500 hertz peak, third harmonics,
that's what you hear.
That's quite obvious. Yeah. And I think you hear it in a way, but you can,
I think so too,
attach the right amplifier. Maybe the Nuprime will be better, because it's a little bit more warm.
Mm-hmm.
And then you still have the openness and quickness of the vocal, because it's a very, I think it's a very detail-rich loudspeaker.
And what I remember, they started with this flex material in 2013.
Yeah.
In 2014, we reviewed floor standard.
Yeah, the 926.
Yes.
Yeah.
And our impression by then was, I remember it very well, that we thought it was a warm loudspeaker.
Yeah, but the floor standard, but that's
very
a whole other beast.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah, and one of my colleagues from the network industry uses the 926 with a Denon amp, if I remember correctly, or maybe a Cambridge audio now. And it's indeed warmer, but it has an extra unit, and maybe...
And the casing is different.
It's different, and maybe the resonance of the casing reveals... No, camouflage is the
mm-hmm.
1500 hertz peak, or maybe the crossovers are different. They are, probably.
They are.
They are.
Different.
Yeah.
But the price was about the same, wasn't it? I don't remember.
€1,000 a piece, I think.
I'll look it up.
Yeah, we can look it up. But it's an interesting one. I'm going to attach the Nuprime. Yeah. I'm really curious.
So we're going to Nuprime?
Yeah.
Nuprime is an American-based audio brand founded by Jason Lim in Singapore. Jason Lim is a very interesting story. He founded New Force. And then New Force was, I have to be accurate, it was again sold to
Optoma.
Thank you, Jaap. I told you just an hour ago. And then he founded two companies, New OEM and New Prime. Yeah. And their claim to fame is that they don't want a hefty price tag on their stuff. So you see underneath on my right, next to underneath the Mutec clock USB interface, you see the Nuprime integrated amplifier. Wait a minute. 1250 euros. The IDA8 hybrid class A/DAMP 100 watts in 8 and 4 ohms. It has analog input and 4 digital. And it can encode DSD PCM up to 32 bit 384 kilohertz.
Yeah.
And even quad DSD. So that's quite something because it's. You can say a prime deck, and it has an integrated amp in it.
Yeah,
on board. So that's well.
We run this a little bit different because with the Yamaha and the Pass, there's of course no DA converter in it. So we need to use the Grimm in this case, the UC1. But now we're gonna go coaxial in on the Nuprime.
So we use the
internal deck, nothing else. So this is really the 1,000 euro
so
combination.
It's from the streaming PC, not
Well, Mutec. The Mutec. Yeah, we need it as a bridge. Well, otherwise, we could do USB directly into the Nuprime, but then Roon would be
ruined. So
music. Yeah, but I need to volume control it. So you can say if it's okay.
Do you want again Tom's Diner for the control?
No, it's okay. You can run the track around 70 dB. Okay, Eric.
Drums echoing tonight, she hears only whispers of some quiet conversation. She's coming in 12:30 flight, the moonlit wings reflect the stars that guide me towards salvation. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words. Turn to me as if to say, hurry boy, it's waiting there for you. Cry out in the night as they grow restless, longing for some solitary company. know that I must do what's right. Sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti, I seek to cure what's deep inside, frightened of this thing that I've become.
Alright.
Okay.
Yeah, Eric.
Point taken.
I think this was a lot better, but we got some feedback on the chat. And they are absolutely right. Could be the recording. Maybe Toto is just way better recorded. So we're going to play a little bit of Jacques Loucher. Not the whole track.
Before the stream, I chose the tracks to be played.
Yeah.
And it was on the pass. And Toto sounded completely different on the pass, I can tell you.
It was not really nice.
It revealed too much.
Oh, Toto.
Toto.
Toto, yeah, it was too revealing. I think you don't want to feed these vocals with nitro.
So all tracks we play now, we played on the pass because it was the first amp we used.
Yeah.
And they all had the same sound, sonic signature, actually.
Yeah, they did.
But
yeah,
and we'll catch it because it's puzzling. We didn't do this test in this dramatic form before, so it's interesting why it sounds so much better and coherent. And
I think this is the best match.
Yeah,
definitely, and it's the cheapest. But we'll try Jacques Loucher, and then we know more.
Okay, Jacques. You're
Jacques,
on.
There you go. Okay, Erik, gaan we.
Yeah.
All right.
So we try to keep quiet. So
well, yeah, or maybe Eric forgot to switch off our vocal mics. I don't know.
No.
No. Okay.
It's your new plugin.
Okay.
Told you so.
No. He switches off these if we're playing music. But we will keep our mouths shut so you don't have us talking in the background.
This is the proof of the pudding, in my opinion.
I think this was nicer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Of course, you miss something. You miss depth in the drum.
Yeah.
Floor tom or
but
toms.
It's better balanced.
Yeah.
And Wayne said, or maybe no, it's RMC Audio said it was better on the pass. I don't agree. Yes, it's more rich in resolution on the pass. Yes, maybe the stereo image was better, but this is better balanced.
It was not pleasant on the.
No.
It was well. It depends on what you define as better.
Yeah.
I think yes, it's better in terms of what you just said, but in terms of listening to music,
yeah,
which is actually the purpose of what we're doing right now.
True, true.
I prefer the Nuprime.
Me too, absolutely. I definitely prefer the Nuprime on these loudspeakers for home use.
So you know Nuprime?
Yeah, a little bit.
Is there a signature or is there a kind of a
yeah, there is.
What does Nuprime do different from, let's say, Yamaha or
Nuprime is more round sounding. It's kind of generous in the mid bass, and it makes it a very friendly sounding amplifier and a very good all-rounder. The Yamaha is tuned completely neutral, so I think vocal work and hi-hats, if you have the right speaker, are brilliant on the Yamaha, but it's not always the best amp, as you could hear. And I think the Nuprime will sound good on anything because it's kind of, well, friendly sounding.
Mm-hmm. And it also has a lot of control.
Yeah, it's 100 watt in class D. Well, it's a hybrid class AD. It's a really weird topology.
What is hybrid class AD? Because I know class A and class D, I know.
Well, they combined it. So it gets really warm, actually. I think it's a couple of watts in class A, and then it switches to class D, which is weird.
Yes. I know hybrid class AB.
Yes.
That's the pass.
And hybrid class D, like NAD uses a lot. But hybrid class AD.
Class D is often used in active loudspeakers because it's small and it doesn't produce much heat. So
no, loads of power. Efficient.
Yeah.
And class A is very inefficient because it's always on. And you use it and then it just uses that energy to go to the loudspeaker. But it's very pure, and class D is switching. So the higher the switching frequency, the better. But you need good filtering. And well, you know, from the early days, class D was really harsh.
Yeah.
And well, that's gone, as you could hear.
Yeah.
It's not harsh at all. But you can look it up.
Next level class D.
It's good, I think. And we used the internal deck,
which is also
not bad.
Well, good.
It's just good. So yeah, Nuprime was good in this case.
The match was good.
The match was good. Yeah, definitely.
So now we gonna switch.
Yeah,
two speakers.
Two questions. Which Nuprime are you using? The IDA8, and there was a. Someone is calling. There was a comment on our music, and they said Alpha Audio never uses metal music in their live streams. Well, no, not in our live streams, but we do play metal.
Yeah, that's because of me. I hate metal.
Yeah, I do like Tool, because they said, yeah, could you use Tool? I love Tool. It's brilliant.
But we, yeah. So what you want? We can play something if you have time.
Well, in the end, we'll play some Tool maybe.
Slayer?
Eric, I'm going to switch the loudspeakers. I'll give a key when you have to put it in mono, okay?
You're absolutely right. But that's because Yeah, I don't like metal, especially not on Sunday, but actually not on any day of the week.
I don't like metal.
I play in a band, but I hate four chord songs, and I hate it. I think it's, well, it doesn't make me happy.
No.
So that doesn't mean there isn't good metal, though. But as Jaap said, maybe if we have time, and then I'll just go to the bathroom and you play some metal. But we do have some readers who are actually says, okay, I'm looking for a system and I play metal, and metal actually demands quite something of your system, because it has many layering. It has, of course, in a whole range of frequencies, it's quite busy. So you need a system that can handle it. So maybe we should have a special on metal sometime. Then I just go into my
metal special,
out of my comfort zone. We'll do some metal.
There's also well-recorded metal.
There is. Now, I was in a music store once, and I had auditioned something. I don't know what. And after my visit, there was something who was auditioning metal, and I said to the guy from the store, okay, metal, come on, it's all... Why would he have a system for like, I don't know, 20,000 euros or so? Well, there is metal that is very well recorded, and you can really hear. And I, from a distance, I can only taste. I'm getting old and grumpy. Don't I? Well, Elac, let's go to Germany. Or Elac, if they... Elac used to make sewing machines.
Yeah.
So maybe in your home, on the attic or so, there is an Elac sewing machine. But it's a German brand, already founded in 1926 in Kiel. It's in the northern part of Germany, facing the Denmark border. And it was founded as Electroacoustic GmbH. And it was founded to focus on the development of sonar technology and the research of signal and sound channels in air and water. And that's actually, that's nice, because we see that a lot of domestic audio, of audio companies, are started out as measuring companies.
Yep.
So Brühl & Kjær, that's the famous microphone company that also that was related to DPA.
Yeah.
Brühl & Kjær was also measuring dBs, so sound. So the measuring stuff we have, that let's say 120 dB is like a plane over your head, that's measured by Brühl & Kjær microphones in the 50s.
True.
So all these companies started out for the professional market. And research and technology.
Can I do the noise thing and then sit with you?
Let's go ahead. Yes.
Okay, Eric.
You're gonna put up some metal.
Oh, I need to.
Now Jaap is going to check the phase correctness.
Recordation.
And
moet even op de.
Getting the pink noise.
Yeah. Wacht even.
Can I just go on chatting now?
Yes.
Okay. I have so much to talk with you about. Okay, in 1993, Elac introduced, that's an interesting for here, the ribbon tweeter, jet folded. And actually, we like Elac a lot. You can read it in the reviews. We are not biased or so, but somehow, you know, it's a match. And we also like that they are still in Germany. They are still owned. I think they're still privately owned. And that gives this brand a kind of a signature sonically, but also in terms of design. That's what we like.
Sorry, yeah.
How's it going?
The thingy is not up still.
Oh, is there still?
I have to reroute this thing. I need to get it close, otherwise.
Also make electronics.
Okay, I'm back. Okay, Eric. My phone.
Now I see that they also make a record player. And they make amplifiers.
Eric, can you switch off the vocal mics?
And I'll just keep talking until the pink noise is coming on. It's okay.
Yep. Okay. Oh. Good. That's good. Okay, we're back.
Did you know that they also had a record player?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
So much going on in terms
of...
Yeah,
it is quite hard to do everything at once.
Yeah.
Don't forget to put it on 105, Eric. Otherwise, the guys don't have stereo. But it's an interesting company, isn't it?
It is.
It goes way back, and it did a lot.
It seems to be still privately owned.
Serious?
But I don't... I didn't... Maybe you know, but...
I didn't know. I looked up some.
There
some
are
history.
Quite some German companies that, like Sennheiser. Sennheiser is still LLC, so a private company, or GmbH, or BV, or.
True.
And Sennheiser is a big, big company, but
Sennheiser
they're still
huge.
The Sennheiser family is in the company's management. And what I know from German companies, they have the same. Other microphone companies and
wow,
somehow they say, well, it's okay. Maybe you want to buy us, but we don't want to be bought.
Well, I think that's very strong. What struck me is that Elac went to a big German fair with their new phono cartridge, and you know who supplied the needle for that cartridge?
The stylus?
Yeah. Guess.
Autophone?
No. Van den Hul. In 1981. So that's 41 years back, people. Van den Hul supplied the stylus for the special Elac cartridge.
I like to review that one, the record player.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. And they started producing loudspeakers in 84.
Yeah.
And they still do today. And
I told the viewers that we like Elac somehow.
I do like Elac. They are very affordable. Most of the loudspeakers are very good, made by Elac. Jeffrey reviewed a lot of Elac speakers.
Yeah. So Jeff, let us know.
He did this one.
Yes, you can
look
it up.
So you can look it up. The UBR62. It's a three-way bass reflex with a coaxial unit. So it's very phase coherent. It should be. I don't think that... Jeff can explain more about that,
in
the chat. So it's a three-way. It goes a bit deeper. A lot deeper. This one goes to 41. The vocal went to 55. So that's maybe why some viewers... missed some bass. It's not really a...
No, it's not. Not for heavy metal.
You need a subwoofer. But let's play some music, Hume. Just...
Yep. So we have the pass again.
Yeah.
The pass labs. And the pass is paired with Jacques Lussier.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. I see a lot of comments in the chat. Very detailed. I prefer the vocal, more mature sound, a little bit harsh. Yeah, it goes all over the place.
It's bumpy.
It's a bumpy road.
So I understand what Hamilton is facing in his Mercedes. You know, there's too much power for a chassis that's maybe not fit for the...
for the track, yeah.
So this is a free tip from Alpha Audio. We recommend Mercedes your patronage for this tip.
Yeah.
There's something wrong. Well, there's the same. It's actually maybe the same thing. That there's too much detail. There's the amp asks too much from the speaker, who simply cannot deliver.
But that's a very good lesson for us and also for the viewers. I do hear that this is just too much for this loudspeaker. It's too much power. It's too much resolution. It's just too much of everything. And that's why I think you hear it as bumpy, because there are some moments in the track that you think, whoa, that's amazing. And then it's just too much. And then, you know, it
when we would play at let's say 60 dB, would it be better?
No.
No, I don't.
No, it doesn't get any better. If you play it louder, it will be too much up front. If you play it softer, you will miss some detail because it's bass reflex. It needs some,
volume. Juice.
Yeah, it needs some juice to produce bass. But Wayne Seto says, could it be the style of the music? Yeah, in a way, I think. But Paul McGowan read my mind in one of his latest vlogs.
He did.
Yeah, because I always preach that a hi-fi system shouldn't be for one genre. How long do I say that?
Yes, I
think for at least 12,
at least,
13
at
years.
At least he listens to you.
I don't believe in a hi-fi system for a specific genre, and he said the same. You know, a good system, cheap or expensive, should play everything. If it's in balance, it plays everything.
Sure.
That's what I think. But still, we get questions like, I play a lot of metal, I play a lot of jazz, I play a lot of vocal, what
system?
Well,
it says something to me about what someone is missing.
That's
so
true.
You miss bass response, or you miss, I don't know, clarity or soundstage or...
True, yeah. Yeah,
more
you
oomph.
Could... More oomph. Well, more oomph is always
oomph.
Better.
More oomph is always goomph.
But I think that this combination is just too much, and it's a good lesson. There is a certain limit in what you should invest in amplification with certain loudspeakers.
Yeah.
And I think I reached... the limits with this.
Do you
Elac.
Think there is a speaker in this range that would match with the pass?
No.
Apart from these three?
Revel.
Yeah, Revel.
Revel is really good.
Revel, yeah.
Maybe €1,000. Damn.
1,200.
That's really hard. But Revel, I have.
Dali?
No. No, sorry. Yeah, no.
Pure
no.
Acoustics?
Concept 30, but it's more expensive.
Yeah.
We haven't heard the Sonus Fabers yet. I have high hopes for Sonus Faber. It's
yeah, because a long time ago we heard that one, I think, or
a... Yeah, the bigger one.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Macintosh.
It was really good. But let's go to the Yamaha.
Yeah.
I'm curious. Oh, Magnabon. Thank you, RMC. Magnabon is also amazing. Yeah, could work.
Yes, that's the different topology of a speaker, of course.
Yeah,
but you're right.
And it's really good.
Yeah, we like Maggie's.
Yeah, I do.
But we never get to review them.
No, that's because of the distributor in the Netherlands.
Yeah. So, Magnabon, if you're listening, just to ship some directly to us.
Yeah.
What can we tell more about? Okay, did you share? It's a three-way bass reflex system.
Yeah. I did tell them about the coaxial unit.
I missed that. Sorry.
Oh wait. There is one thing about the Elac. The sensitivity is very low. I think it was 84?
Yeah, 85.
85, yeah, it's pretty low.
Well, the Lumina is 86. No, that's
yeah, but this one is 89,
86,
88. 86. Yeah, the Focal, I mean. It's a lot
Elac
higher.
Elac is, yeah. And the crossover is at 260 for the...
Yeah, an 1800.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird. After this track, we will discuss the measurements. Yeah, I first want to hear the Yamaha, and then we discuss the measurements, and then we go to the Nuprime. So,
okay, Luca. Yeah.
Luca. That's an interesting one.
Measurements.
Yeah. Well, first, what did you think?
Me?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
I'm
you, Hume.
Yeah.
You.
I'm always surprised by the knowledgeableness. I don't know if that's correct English. By the readers. Sometimes I have the impression that you hear more or even as much as we do.
I think they hear the same tonal balance differences and maybe even presentation, yeah. I mean, our mic setup is better than the speaker.
Yeah.
It's not the weak link in this case. I mean, if you go to 500,000 euro systems, maybe the mics will be
Well, I thought that, you know, I saw in stream 900 euros a pair. So that's 300 euros less than than the vocals and 200 less than the Sonus Faber.
Yeah.
And of course you can say price doesn't matter, but it does.
It does.
I think when you are below 1,000, you have a different
expectation.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
And I thought the mesh was, you know, it could be better, but it was much better than a vocal.
It does.
Indeed, as I think BB Photo, said that.
Yeah.
That the vocal presentation of Suzanne Vega's voice was different than with the vocal.
No, I see. Needs more cowbell. I don't know what that means, but
needs more cowbell.
Yeah, somewhere in the chat.
What the sound?
BJ 1994 needs more cowbell. What does that mean?
Cowbell is something.
Yeah,
for,
I know.
For percussion.
Oh, maybe he misses that in the presentation.
Some say that it was a little bit boring.
I don't think it's boring. I think it's more relaxing than the vocal. But it is, Elac is quite neutral. It's a German brand. German is correct, just like the Neumann loudspeakers.
And they measure, share the measurements.
I'll share them.
It almost always, the measurements are correct.
Yeah, correct. Okay, Eric, you can put in the laptop, then I'll discuss the measurements. I'll start with the frequency response. As you can see here, this is the full no windowed measurement, and it's quite flat already. You can see that the bass response is, well, it's bass reflex, so I should have measured the port separately. Then you get a more detailed insight of the bass response, but it's without any windowing, it's quite flat. It's amazing how this loudspeaker measures. The vocal did really well in that aspect as well. I was quite surprised, maybe because it's not a lot of energy they pump into the room, that you don't hear the room that much. Could be. This is windowed. As you can see, it's quite a flat line. They do really well in the measurements. Impulse response, like with the vocal, I'll put this in the full review of these loudspeakers. Then you can see what it means. It's actually how the speaker reacts on the input signal. There should be a minimum amount of ringing. Now this gets interesting because the Elac, the perceptual simultaneous distortion is a lot lower than with the vocal. And I think this is where Jung is very sensitive. In the 1500 Hertz region where the vocals are also present, there is no extra distortion in our perception. And if you look at the normal distortion measurement, you can see there's a small bump around 250, which is, yeah, surprising actually. But you don't hear it that much, just a little bit. It's above in the normal measurement, but in the perceptual distortion, it's equal. So maybe they know the effect. And something that struck me is that the second harmonic is much more dominant than the third. And with the vocal, it's the other way around. So that's something that we hear, definitely hear. But it measures quite well.
It does.
And it doesn't measure, well, in some ways, it's even better than the vocal. And that surprises me. So.
It doesn't surprise me at all, because it's the German loudspeaker and also, these German.
Yeah, but it's 300 euros less expensive.
Yes, but even then, you know, the German reviewers, our colleagues in Germany, they have their own measurement instruments. So you first get the measurements.
Yeah.
And then you get the sound. And when you hear the British colleagues, they first have their impressions that they have a nice whiskey and they're sitting in front of their log.
Yeah, and probably.
And they describe on the tune. And there are reviews who don't give you any clue on what they have listened to, only the system and not the specs. And I think the Germans, they like measurements.
And yeah, I like both. You need to listen and you need to measure.
That's why we're in Netherlands. We're neutral.
We're neutral. Yeah, I think you need both. Measurements give a sense of direction if you're doing stuff the correct way, and you have some anchor points. And listening, you need listening to know what you are actually measuring, because what's the effect of this? Like, the perceptual distortion for me is getting more important every time I see it, because it gives you a sense of what a loudspeaker actually sounds like. And that's why I like Illisonic. He's kind of the sound wizard for me.
He is.
He really knows.
Christoph Faller.
He's a genius.
Give it up to Christoph Faller, guys.
Yeah. Christoph, you're doing good. Nuprime. I'll swap the amps and you can say maybe something about, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. About something.
About something. Just talk.
I'll talk. Well, there were some suggestions in the chat on next things we can do, and it was very helpful. What we also find out from the streams we did with Artone was that microphones and DA conversion and mastering are very important. And maybe to demonstrate that, we are thinking about, at least I'm thinking about a setup where we use different kinds of microphones, where we try different kinds of mastering. Yeah. We tend to hate more and more remasters because they're too much too loud. They're less detailed, they're less engaging. And we tend to go back to the original master. Definitely. And a third one is, that was also very interesting, mixing is now used with digital audio workstations such as Pro Tools or Logic, and some people say that it matters on which DAW DAW you are working.
Yeah.
So cannot expect this in the next stream, but we are working on, you know, ways to share with you all the variables in, let's say, the recording process, because now, up to now, we have done the result, that's the recording.
Yeah.
But we have found out, and it's true actually, that, you know, the choice of your microphones, your mastering matters so much in how it actually sounds.
How it actually sounds.
Sounds.
Yeah, definitely.
So, enough talking.
Yeah, let's go to the Nuprime. Okay, Eric, there we go.
Waiting there for you. Gotta take the life and
dogs cry out in the night as they grow restless, longing for some solitary company. I know that I must do what's right, sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti. I seek to cure what's deep inside, frightened of this thing that I've become.
All right. Damn. like some of the people in the chat, maybe the most surprising of all is that match with the Nuprime.
Yeah.
It's a really, really nice amplifier, and the IDA8, it is. I think still the Yamaha and the Pass are just too much for this price category.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that's why it gets a little bit restless and like staccato sounding.
Yeah.
Although the Elac did better on the Yamaha than the Focal, but the Focal also matched the best with the Nuprime. And this Elac also matches the best with the Nuprime. Surprising, well, in a way, maybe.
Yes, because up to now I always thought, okay, when you hook up a better amp, it sounds better.
Yeah.
That's my expectation. And well, maybe in a way, the pass was too much, but I thought, okay, the Yamaha should do the job better than a par-priced amplifier.
I thought as well, actually. I thought it would be better as well, but it isn't. I think this is the most musical combination of all.
Yeah. And of course, there are more alternatives in this price tag. You have the Cyrus, you have the PS Audio.
Cyrus 1HD. The Sprout is around that price. Audio Lab 6000A is a little bit beneath. The 8000A is a little bit above. Yeah, there are a lot of amps. Well, we tested 10 of them.
Yeah.
So you can check them out. I'm going to swap these speakers and you can tell something about Sonus Faber.
Well, we're moving to Italy. Actually, we have an all European... No, not.
Mostly European.
Well, that is France, we have Germany and Italy. Well, Sonus Faber. In the higher end speakers, you can choose your kind of leather you want on top of the speaker. So it's from Italy. Have you been to the factory yet?
No, not yet. But I want to.
So it's really Italian. Also, these little guys, they're the cheapest in the range or the most affordable. And they always look gorgeous.
Oh,
wood and metal and... Well, this one doesn't have leather, fortunately.
Yeah, well, fake leather.
Fake leather.
Yeah, definitely.
Some.
See?
Yeah. Nice.
You can caress it.
And, So we do like the brand as well. The higher in the series there, you know, they are a little bit shaped roundish shaped, and especially the floor standards are really gorgeous and to my taste. And now we have the Lumina 2. Two-way bassy flex, a tweeter and a woofer for made from paper. Oh, here's, and the crossover is the same as Elac at 1800 hertz, and it has a sensitivity of 86 dBs, and the frequency range is quite more or less the same as the focal, 55 to 24 k.
Can I
swap
it? Let me see. Eric, there we go. All right. I get better at it.
Or very fast.
Yeah, sometimes it just works. Well, we had enough practice. But what's interesting about Sonus Faber, like you said, the floor standing models are really nice looking, but they didn't produce floor standing speakers up until 2001. The Amati Homage. 1998, and in 2001 the Cremona was launched, and it was also a floor standing speaker. But up until 1998, there was no floor standing speaker. So for 15 years, Sonus Faber only produced bookshelves. In 2009, Fine Sounds was in the process of buying Sonus Faber, and you can see the shift, like you mentioned, the design of those floor standing speakers. That shift was in 2010, so I think it was because of Fine Sounds that they swapped out the design. But Franco Serblin isn't in the company for a while. He was the founder of Sonus Faber, and some people say that he was the genius behind the sound of Sonus Faber. I don't know about that. I heard some Sonus Faber models on a Unison Research in my store days at Wilbert, and it sounded incredible. I must admit, they sounded really, really, really good. Now they're, I think, famous for their design. I mean, it's Italian design. It just looks gorgeous.
Even this one is.
Yeah, it's really good.
It's bought by the Macintosh Group.
Yeah. Yeah, and Found Sounds is owner of Macintosh, I think. That's what I think. But I'm not really into all the company stuff. It's large.
Yeah, and I read here that Maserati uses or uses Sonus Faber in their cars. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Yeah, all those hi-fi brands are now into car audio. I think they want the people that drive a Maserati to buy their loudspeakers and yeah, stuff like that. The cool thing is, I don't know the name of the new version, but he created, Franco Serblin created the Snill in 1980. And maybe Eric can put my laptop on screen. Sonus Faber, the Snill, which is pretty cool. Yeah, there it is. You see this thing, the Snill.
Wow.
He created that in 1980. Do you see this loudspeaker? That's their all-in-one. It's yeah. 10,000 euros. It's the same design. Yes, yes, yes. And the cool thing about this is that it's motorized. So these arms go out with a motor. Really cool stuff. But the design was already done in 1980. I didn't know that. Pretty cool.
Yes, man.
Pretty cool. Okay, about...
Shall we listen to the music, or is there more to tell about?
No, not really. We'll check the measurements and the specs after this track.
Okay, so we already have the pass now.
Yeah.
Pass laps on the Sonus Faber.
Yeah, there we go. Whoa.
This was
A whole other experience. Damn.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you all already reacted, but it was
yeah, well,
different in
the EQ curve, yes, we'll show that in a minute. There is a different EQ in this loudspeaker. Yeah. But I don't care about the EQ. It's the harshness that is gone.
Yeah. Except for the, you know, the cymbals, but...
That's the EQ.
That's the EQ.
I can show you why we thought, okay, yeah, that's a little bit too much. But, holy moly.
Oh, yes.
The harshness is completely gone on this setup, and that's impressive. Yeah, maybe
it sounded at least the first minute was quite coherent, even
definitely quite coherent. But then there is no high frequencies in there. Okay, Eric, can you put on the laptop? This is the EQ. See, it's the Bauer's bump, but a little bit further up. we've, you know, this bump up there, that we call it the Bauer's bump, because all Bauers and Wilkins have that bump, but it's from 4K and up. So, and they shifted it a little bit more up in the spectrum, so it's not as obvious as with Bowers and Wilkins, and it's not as tiring as Bowers and Wilkins. Mm. I think this is a better choice if you decide to EQ your loudspeaker. If we go to 3 milliseconds, it's not as flat as the Elac and Focal, but it's only the bump, and it's like 4 dB.
But why would you EQ the loudspeaker? Because you think that then they assume that the amplifiers connected to these speakers don't deliver these mid-highs.
No, it's purely commercial. You stand out.
Ah.
Because you think, oh, that's airy. Oh, that's nice. Oh, no. Wow, this is much better.
You're comparing it next to others.
It's just to stand out in a store.
Yeah.
I don't like loudspeakers that are EQ'd like this, because you heard it immediately when they hit the cymbals. And we notice it. I think they don't need it, because damn, this is a good loudspeaker. I didn't expect this. Well, this was microphone in midpoint, and this is microphone on tweeter. There's hardly any difference, so that's good. It's very phase coherent. That's what it shows me. If you look at the distortion, and let's go down, see how ridiculously low the distortion is. They know what they are doing. And that's the same with Bowers and Wilkins. They know what they're doing. So why EQ a loudspeaker like that? The distortion is really, really, really low in this loudspeaker. So I'm impressed. Like I said, I didn't look at all the measurements before we went discussing them. And now I see, damn, that's really good. And it shows why it's not harsh.
And could you explain from measurements or from own knowledge why this speaker sounds so much better than the other two?
Yeah, because the distortion is more than 10 decibels lower than the others.
Okay.
10.
Yes, that makes a difference.
Yeah. So we're looking at below 1% at already 90 hertz. And that's really good, because if you drop below 1%, so low, and it even goes to 0.01% at the mid range, and that's why the mid range is so clean, and that's why the pass still sounds so good on this loudspeaker. Okay, enough promotion for the Sonus Faber. The sensitivity
86
it was, yes, 86.
And the price tag is €1,100.
Yeah, so it's a
so again, the Elac is 900, Sonus Faber 1100, and the Focal 1200.
Yeah.
So they're pretty close.
Pretty close, yeah.
In terms of price.
But you do need a pair of stand mounts still. They have a very large tweeter. It's 29 millimeters. That's quite... Yeah,
that's why I'm surprised, because why they tweak mid-high that much, because the tweeter is... It's a dome tweeter.
Yeah. Crossover is at 1800.
Yeah.
So it's a most of them are 25 to stay out of this focal mid-range, but I think 1800 is okay. Depends on how you filter. Yeah. I don't know the order of the filtering.
Let's do Yamaha.
Yeah, I need to swap them, but okay, it makes sense to me now. That's the most important thing.
Because I see it's almost 10 to 12:30, so.
We already knew it was quite a daunting test to do.
Okay, so now the Yamaha.
Yeah. should be okay.
Sorry, guys.
Okay.
AS2200.
Yeah.
On the Sonus Faber Lumina 2.
All say this sounds really good. Oh man, are we way off on this one? Yeah, sorry, we'll turn it back. It sounds kind of harsh. Yeah, whatever.
After that, you don't ask why, you just don't ask.
Well, that's the first time that there was a difference between what you heard and what we, because here we really wanted to switch it off because it was too much high and too little bass. But apparently on the headphones and at your home, it was. And I must say that the in the system, I heard the speaker disappear. So that was a good thing. I heard the music, not the speakers. Yep. It was very
coherent.
Soundstage was nice. The holographic display was right. But we'll see what Africa does on the Nuprime. You're being called again, Jaap. I don't know what's that.
Yeah. I don't care.
We don't have call-in facility, so
no, not yet.
It's useless to know. We won't do that.
We will do that later.
Africa.
Do what's right. Sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti, I seek to cure what's deep inside, frightened of this thing that I've become.
Sorry for the coughing, guys.
Yeah, we do mute the microphones, but you have to realize that the the microphones for the sampling are omnidirectional, so you hear everything. But yeah, you can't just hold his breath for 6 minutes. That's it's gonna be hard. I'm gonna put the pause on. Just a minute of Toto, just to see what it does.
I thought metal, okay, Toto.
And then one bonus track of metal, okay?
But this sounded quite good, actually. Yeah. And of course you missed the bass response, as the viewers always, but that's... Because this is a closed system, right? But on at the front?
Yeah.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah, they did a good job.
Okay, we hear some more cowbells. Yes?
Africa. Whoa!
Okay. There's the bass. Oh.
The drums echoing tonight, and she hears only whispers of some quiet conversation. She's coming in 12:30 flight. The moonlit wings reflect the stars that guide me towards salvation. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words. To me as if to say, hurry boy, it's waiting there for you. Longing for some solitary company. I know that I must do what's right. As sure as Kilimanjaro rises like a lamp rise above the sea.
Okay, this was completely unexpected and completely ridiculous.
So our recommendation
by a pass
16K
labs.
Pass labs in 1100 Sonus Faber, but the key is in low distortion, actually.
Yeah, lower distortion. Just
then you're
just that.
You're okay.
Yeah. Wow, that was so much better than I expected. Metallica is a really bad recording, by the way. That's
then we do Slayer.
Okay, who wants some metal? Last recording, just for fun.
It's for the Sunday.
Just for keeping us awake. We need some food, and we've been online for 2.5 hours. Or
no, 2 hours.
2 hours. So it's enough. So recommendations for the
well recorded.
Tool was good.
I had a tool.
Tool, yeah, tool, yeah, RMC Audio, yeah, tool.
Tool, tool, okay.
Tempest is cool, yeah, the last recorder, die blauwe links.
Dit?
Ja.
And then, Fear Inoculum, Pneuma. Mocking Beat.
We'll do a part of Tempest.
Okay, one of my favorites.
Pneuma. Tool. Yeah, it's cool. It's cool. I know. Tempest. 10,000 Days. But we'll just pick Tempest. We have it on the NAS.
15 minutes, huh?
Ja, maar we draaien hem gewoon weg. Pneuma. Staat hij er ook op? Ja, Pneuma. All right. There we go. Pneuma.
Kom hard.
This is it. Okay. Yeah, it is bearable. This is prog rock. I absolutely love Tool. But I like progressive metal. But I like metal as well. So we sometimes use it in reviews, not with Jung in the room. Because as soon as I put on, I don't know, Fear Factory or Dimmu Borgir, he will be gone. Just like big metal jazz for me. I just can't bear it.
Big band, yes.
Well,
that's okay.
This is okay. Yeah, it's really well recorded as well, by the way.
But here you hear the you missed the bass.
Yeah, I did miss
the
some
double
bass.
The double bass drum, the kick drum
was gone.
It's gone.
Yeah.
So
it's a small loudspeaker, and you need subwoofers if you play music like this. But it is a very good loudspeaker.
It is. And I think, oh no, I don't know what the acoustic treatment does in this room for these speakers, because I think they're not meant to be played in a treated room, actually. And as someone in the chat said, okay, the readers and the viewers here are used to systems that are maybe 10 times as expensive as what we hear listening right now.
Yeah, could be.
So how honest this is to audition this in a room with so much acoustic treatment, with bass straps, with absorbers? I don't know. It's just an open question. But
I think it's a really good question. And this room is pretty flat and pretty damped for live streams like this and for auditioning systems, so you can hear the differences more easily. In most living rooms, you hear the room. And
I think at home, generally, in a normal living room, listening room, you would have more energy maybe with these speakers.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So the bass response here totally disappears in this room.
Yeah.
Even with the pass labs.
But we did get bass back with the pass labs.
Yes.
That was funny.
Yeah.
It has more grunt. It has a huge power supply. So in this case, with a loudspeaker that has very low distortion, it works. And you could hear that. It matches pretty well with the pass labs. And no one will buy a 16,000 euro amp for these loudspeakers. But what struck me is that you could hear the difference and it didn't get uneasy or unbalanced. So that's a big kudos to the Sonus Faber speaker. And with the Focal, it was horrible. And with the Elac, it didn't work as well. So, yeah. For me, the conclusion is that from the three loudspeakers, the Sonus Faber is the most clean.
Yeah.
In terms of distortion, I have to be careful now because there's also a lot of taste involved in choosing a loudspeaker.
But you're right. It in measurements, it demonstrates that the distortion is the lowest on
the
this
lowest
one.
And you can hear that on combinations like bizarre combinations like the pass labs.
I think the Elac in matters of in terms of taste, the combination Elac with the Nuprime was amazing.
It was really good. Yeah. Was amazing. It was warm and it was pleasant. And you can listen for longer. And you heard it as well. I think we heard the tuning of the Sonus Faber as soon as the cymbals were hit.
Yeah.
And then I thought, why?
Yeah.
And with Tool as well, the hi-hats were really present. And I know they are not recorded like that.
Mm.
Yes, they are present, but that it's just like the measurement said, 40 dB too much.
Yeah.
Just over the edge. The Focal matched the best with the Nuprime as well.
Yeah.
And I don't think that it was very pleasant with the Yamaha. It's just too much mid and high.
Yeah.
Well, like they said in the chat, the big winner is Nuprime.
The winner is Nuprime.
The winner is Nuprime. Yeah.
But it was nice to do. Nice to do this kind of, it was complicated. And I'm glad we didn't have any disturbances or any stuff that didn't work.
It worked pretty well.
We demonstrated that matching with speakers, amps, is very, very, very important.
Very important, yes. And it's all about balance.
Try it at home. Use your ears.
Yes, you definitely never ever buy a loudspeaker or an amplifier without auditioning it, because it will not work. You can hear it here. I couldn't predict the outcome, and I never ever could have predicted that the Nuprime would be a better match than the Yamaha, because I know how good the Yamaha is, but it doesn't match on the Elac and the Focal. And it did match on the Sonus Faber. Actually, we can say the Sonus Faber matched on everything.
Yeah,
it's crazy. Now I think about
it. Yes, it matches on everything.
Yeah, that's and on that bombshell, no. I think we're finished, Hume.
Yeah.
So, thank you for sitting on the couch with me again.
Yes, you too.
And thank Eric for doing all the switching and all the technical stuff in the background.
Thank you for preparing everything.
Yes. Well, You're welcome, and thank you all for watching. And if you're not a Patreon member yet, please support us so we can do independent tests like this, because this is all just, you know, we do it live so you can hear it, so you can see us work, and you can see what we need to do to make this all happen. These are expensive tests to do, and it's only possible if you support us as well.
And how can they display? Is it in the comments or in the description, or is
not
it
yet? But if you go to Alpha Audio, the website, in the right upper corner, you see support us with a Patreon button, and you can just click it and help us out. And we have some supporters already, and we're very grateful for that. And we will do more for Patreon supporters in the future. We're working on that. Like we told in the beginning, we're working on a comparison tool on the website, so you can compare all the reviewed stuff in terms of specs, samples, measurements, everything. So, thanks, Jung. See ya.
Enjoy your Sunday. See you next month.
Yes, next month. Bye-bye.